Greetings, one and all, and welcome. This is the Simstress, and you are here for another installment of Time Traveler. Today's guest is Pablo Picasso, the one and only. He is artist extraordinaire, romantic, ambitious, and noncommittal. You will hear a lot about that in today's episode. He was quite the person, apart from being someone who influenced the Art Deco movement in the 20s and 30s. He was an amazing artist. I'm sure you've seen his work everywhere. And he's so famous that he may not even need much of an introduction. But today you're going to find out some of the dark and dirtier parts of the amazing artist who changed the face of the art world in the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s. It goes on and on. So without further ado, let's begin. We're going to start with a tongue twister. If anybody wants to try this with me, you're welcome to. He was born Pablo Diego José Francisco de Paola Juan Nepomuceno Crispin Crispiniano Maria Remedios de la Santísima Trinidad Ruiz Picasso, also known as Pablo Ruiz before 1901, or Pablo Ruiz Picasso. He was born October 25th, 1881, Malaga, Spain, and he died April 8th, 1973 in Mougins, France. So that was quite the beginning to his story already. With a name like that, how can you fail in life? So beginning with his family, his father, José Ruiz Blasco, a professor of drawing, very into art himself, and his mother's name was Maria Picasso López. Pablo became his father's pupil, naturally, in art, and in 1891, when his father took focus off of his artwork to support Pablo, he had his first exhibition at the tender age of 13. So dad moved away from his own success and fed everything into Pablo. So the family moved to Barcelona, in Spain, of course, in the autumn of 1895. Pablo entered the art academy there, and by 1897, Pablo Ruiz felt that he needed more, and he moved to Madrid to attend the Royal Academy of San Fernando. He decided that the teachers there were not up to par and began living the, quote, cafe society life, where he painted the world around him, then moving into places where artists normally dared not go, such as brothels. He tended to paint kind of more of the gritty side of Spain as well. As Pablo rose in the ranks of his contemporaries, he observed, and sometimes copied, if we're honest, the works of artists such as Velázquez, El Greco, Murillo, and Goya, very famous artists now, each in their own right. He became very ill in the spring of 1898 and spent the better part of the year recovering. When he returned to Barcelona in 1899, he was a different person. He had gained some weight, began living in the countryside alone. He gave up on his family's dreams for his future, in particular his father, and showed a preference for his mother's surname, Picasso. He dropped it completely by 1901 and became Pablo Picasso. So that's when it all started, folks. He became a part of a circle of artists that had eyes on Paris and moving there to explore their flourishing art scene. His first Barcelona exhibition was in February of 1900. There he showed a painting called Last Moments, which received some attention and claimed a spot at the Exposition Universelle in Paris. He packed up his belongings and, along with his painter friend Carlos Casagemas, he headed to Paris. In Paris, he discovered real color, not the drab Spanish palette, as he called it, that he had grown sick of. But after 2 months, he and Carlos returned to Spain because of a failed relationship for Casagemas. Pablo took an editor's position for an art publication when they did return, but Casagemas was completely unable to get over the failed love affair. So without Pablo, he returned back to Paris. And apparently there was a dinner party. They were out with friends, he drank a lot, and around 9 p.m. on February 17th of 1901, he stood up, he gave a speech, apparently, because that's what you do when you're drunk, and he shot at his girlfriend, Germaine. And he grazed her temple. He didn't kill her, but immediately after shooting her, thinking that he shot her dead, he shot himself. And that was probably the most tragic event in Pablo's life, definitely at that point in his life. So it had a tremendous effect on him, and it stayed with him for quite a while. He was still a young Picasso then, but he turned his grief and guilt into inspiration for a series of paintings, and in fact, in one of them depicted Casamas as an artist in a painting titled La Vie. He began his blue period during this stretch between 1901 and 1904, and he moved back and forth between Barcelona and Spain, taking all of his art supplies with him when he went. 3 months after the death of Carlos Casamas, Picasso found Germaine, who had already been married during all of this, and rejected her lover, Carlos, for just that reason. And he took her on as a mistress. He found her and he decided that they should also have a relationship. So that was the beginning of a really interesting set of events in Picasso's life. I think maybe all of those things that transpired changed the way that he looked at love and relationships. I'm only speculating here, but you'll see what I mean. So he took another mistress shortly afterward. I didn't say he got rid of Germaine, though. her name was Madeline, and there's almost nothing known about this woman. Germaine went on to marry again, apparently. It's very strange, convoluted history, and let me tell you, there is a lot of information about these women. I try to keep it as brief as possible, just to give you an idea of what his life was like. While in Paris, though, he spent a lot of time in the women's prison gathering free models for his paintings. And while in Barcelona, he painted the street people, in quotes, street people. Though the people that he saw, you know, begging in the streets, sometimes blind, very kind of tragic figures that he wanted to paint and depict, you know, the darker side of life. And if you know his work, you may know some of the work that I'm talking about that depicted that. In the spring of 1904, Picasso made the decision to permanently move to Paris, leaving Barcelona behind, even though it was still in his heart and he was a true Spaniard. But soon after moving to Paris, he began what people call his rose period. This was put in quotes quite a bit. I'm not even sure why, because a lot of people do know about his rose period, but this is where his work began to reflect more intellectual pursuits. He wanted to represent the struggle of artists, poets, and those entertaining the public. In particular, he became enamored with the circus performer life and the balancing act of all artists in societies as a theme that he really played on, painting himself as a harlequin a lot of times, kind of the joker, the jester. He began a relationship with a fellow artist, a friendly relationship in this case, with Guillaume Apollinaire. You probably have heard of him if you know anything about this art world in this period. He took another mistress after that at the end of 1904. Her name was Fernande Olivier. He thought her to be his, quote, first great love, unquote, and her presence inspired a great deal of work and led up to his Cubist period by the end of 1906. One of Picasso's most famous paintings of this period, Les Demoiselles d'Avignon, painted in 1907, began its life as a rolled-up canvas that Picasso did not show or sell for several years, although he had collectors after his work by this time. He appeared to represent the bathing lady subjects of other painters of this period as vulgar masked beings. That was critic description, not mine. Fernand appeared in many of his works during the same period when he was heavily influenced by Cézanne. You can see some subconscious or not mimicry of his airy brushstrokes in his work. They stayed together for 7 years, and she later wrote memoirs about their relationship. By then, Picasso had achieved fame, and he actually paid her to stop writing. He became close friends with Georges Braque. He did a collaboration with him, many collaborations with him, as with no one else in his entire career. Together, they developed analytical cubism. Many critics simply labeled it as geometric art, but the artists believed that they had discovered a new reality in painting. Breaking from Renaissance tradition and classic themes, they attempted to show multiple perspectives of the same object on one canvas. In 1911, gosh, this is a lot, bear with me. In 1911, while still living with Fernand, he fell in love with Eva Göll. He declared his love, naturally in a painting, and eventually, after being with her for a fair amount of time, a few years, Eva died of tuberculosis in 1915. And he was with these women simultaneously. In 1912, Braque and Picasso began working with paper on canvas, making collage art. Objects were morphed and transformed into each other and became a lot more playful and colorful as well. Picasso never stopped painting and continued to grow and develop his vision of the world through his art, but he was equally known for his love of women. He either revered them, painted them, immortalized them in his paintings, or he abused them, allegedly. He was not a faithful man, but he was very passionate. You can definitely say that. As his former girlfriend Eva was dying in 1915, Picasso was told to go see a performer friend of one of his friends in the Parisian cabaret named Gabby. She was also married, and he started an affair with her as well. So they did keep this affair a secret because of her marriage, and years later her niece decided to sell the paintings in her estate after her death and discovered the affair. Probably letters, memoirs, and, you know, journals. Picasso had apparently proposed to Gabby, and she refused. After he was rejected by Gabby, he fell in love and married Irene Lagou, who decided to leave him and return to her previous lover at the end of 1916. This is a whole lot of stuff happening in a very short period. That same year, he began an affair with 20-year-old Emilienne Paquerette. Gertrude Stein mentioned their relationship in her memoirs, as Picasso was always bringing his favorite little woman to her home when invited. Oh my gosh, it's craziness how these all overlap. In 1918, Picasso married again. His new wife was Olga Koklova, a ballet dancer he met while designing ballet sets and costumes. They were married 10 years and produced a son in 1921. Picasso resumed his affairs after the birth, and Olga filed for divorce. Picasso never allowed it to be legalized, and when she died of cancer in 1955, she was still legally married to him. In 1927, 46-year-old Pablo took on Marie-Thérèse Walter, a 17-year-old, while he was still married to Olga. She also became his muse, as so many others had, but was left behind when he met his next love, Dora Maar, in 1936. Maar was a fellow artist who became his next muse, another one, for 7 years, and also photographed Picasso painting in his studio, documenting the painting of his famous anti-war piece called Guernica. Picasso abused Maar and made her aware of his relationship with Marie-Thérèse, and she cried endlessly over her competition with another woman and Picasso's disrespect. He painted her suffering in Picasso's Weeping Women in 1943. They split up in 1943, and Maar suffered a nervous breakdown shortly afterward. She later chose a reclusive life. At age 62, he took up with 22-year-old Françoise Guillot. They moved in together and had two children, and over time, Françoise could no longer abide his abuse and affairs. So she left in 1953. 11 years later, she wrote a book about her life with the famous artist. That same year, Picasso met Jacqueline Roque at a ceramic studio. She too became his muse, and he painted more than 70 paintings of her in 1 year. She was the last woman that he painted for the final 17 years of his life. Now it gets even messier. When Picasso died in 1973, Jacqueline prevented his children from attending the funeral because Pablo had disinherited them when Françoise had written her tell-all book. After the drama was over, Roque returned to the castle on the French Riviera, where she had lived with Picasso until his death, and she commits suicide by shooting herself. Very tragic pattern here. While still in a relationship with Jacqueline, Picasso met Sylvette David. He was instantly smitten, but they never had a sexual relationship, and she never posed nude. They called this his ponytail period because of the one found frequently on Sylvette's head. It was the one and only time that he had not had an affair with a model. In 1928, Picasso began to work with iron and steel as a sculptor. His work remained largely unknown until after his death. He returned to Spain only once in 1934 and never again, although his sympathies remained there. Ceramics became a part of Picasso's expression in the 1940s, but that part of his career was not taken very seriously. His work was commissioned by the political world after World War II, where he created two large panels called War and Peace It was begun in 1952, and I believe it was installed in 1954 at the Temple of Peace in the Côte d'Azur, in a small town where he used to kind of hang out with friends and discuss politics. At the time of Picasso's death, the French state came into ownership of over 50,000 works of Picasso's from various periods of his career, which spanned more than 80 years. I could never cover all of the things that he made, even the famous ones. The list is endless. And there's so much that I didn't include. Oh gosh, but it was a lot. And I thank you for sticking with me if you did. And all of the tongue twisters. It was an interesting one. It's a good thing that I speak both Spanish and French. There was a lot of that going on in this research. So hopefully you like what I've done with his little apartment. And yes, I have found some of his paintings, in quotes, in the gallery, and I've included them in this apartment. It's somewhat modest. It's more about his painting. And as soon as I moved Picasso into 1925 Time Traveler Way, no irony, he hit on Clara Bow immediately. Hopefully you'll get to see some of that in future episodes. I also included in this video the new storage closet, our butler, and Agatha Christie's dog, Miss Lemon. Come on, Poirot fans, stick with me. I hope you liked it. Look forward to our next installment when you will be, I'm sure, surprised, or maybe not, by our next guest. Until then, I hope you're happy, safe, and healthy, and that you have a beautiful day.